The Mexican War of Independence was fought over many issues, and there were a number of independence factions with different goals. From 1521, Mexico was run by the Habsburg dynasty, which was the family in control when the Aztecs were conquered by the Spaniards and their indigenous allies in 1521. During that period, Mexico was ruled as a semi-independent kingdom of the Viceroyalty of New Spain, which was part of the Spanish Empire. Under the Habsburg dynasty, Mexico and other parts of the Spanish Empire had a degree of autonomy, and many of the earliest criollo families had a certain level of authority throughout New Spain. Then, in the year 1700, King Carlos II died childless and without a legitimate successor. After his death, there was a war of succession in Spain, and a new family, the Bourbon dynasty, took over the Spanish Empire. The Bourbon dynasty implemented a number of reforms aimed at modernizing the empire, including centralizing more power in Spain rather than in the colonies, and expelling the Jesuits from Mexico and other places. The details of these reforms would require a separate video, but one of the main issues of contention was the fact that centralizing power meant sending high-level government officials from Spain to Mexico to govern New Spain, which displaced many criollos from positions of power. The other issue was that expelling the Jesuits angered many people in Mexico, since local people had a good relationship with Jesuit missionaries. Also, in 1805, the Spanish government raised taxes on Mexico to pay for a war they were in against the British. The criollos blamed all of these problems on the peninsulares, who were living in Mexico. Even with these reforms, most Mexicans viewed the Spanish colonial authorities as the main problem, not necessarily the King of Spain, who was still seen as the legitimate ruler of New Spain. Remember, this is a time before people wanted a constitution and a republic. We often talk about democracy originating with the Greeks and the Romans, but really, the modern version of a constitutional republic began with the United States and France. Now, let's go back to the issue of independence. In 1808, France, under Napoleon Bonaparte, conquered Spain. After doing so, Napoleon forced the King of Spain, Charles IV, as well as his son, Fernando VII, to abdicate the throne of Spain and to give up the entire Spanish Empire. Surprisingly, they did, and Napoleon installed his brother, Joseph Bonaparte, as King of Spain and as ruler of the Spanish Empire. Joseph had some level of support from some of the elites in Spain, but he was overwhelmingly unpopular by the majority of Spain, and for the most part, he was never recognized by any of Spain's colonies, including Mexico. Throughout Mexico, people became suspicious of the peninsulares in Mexico City. They already didn't like them for having displaced many criollos from power. And now, with Joseph Bonaparte in control on the Iberian Peninsula, many Mexicans were even more suspicious of people from Spain. Throughout Spain and throughout the Spanish Empire, people who were against Joseph Bonaparte began forming provisional governments, and each one claimed to be the true representative of Fernando VII, whom they viewed as the legitimate King of Spain. In Mexico, this caused a lot of confusion. For the first time, really, the legitimacy of the government in Spain and in Mexico City was called into question. I mean, think about it. With so many provisional governments forming in Spain, which one was the legitimate representative of Fernando VII? Also, did the peninsulares, who had caused a lot of anger in Mexico for the past few decades, even have loyalty to Fernando VII? Or were they puppets of Napoleon and Joseph Bonaparte? None of the criollos or other Mexicans really knew for sure. Meanwhile, on the peninsula, the provisional government of Sevilla was beginning to consolidate power among those who were still loyal to Fernando VII. This provisional government was later moved to the city of Cádiz, which is also in Spain. And throughout this entire time, the people of Spain, many of whom were directed by the provisional government of Cádiz, fought against the government of Joseph Bonaparte in what is known as the Peninsular War. The provisional government of Cádiz basically became the vanguard against the French in Spain. People in Mexico didn't know about Fernando VII's abdication until July 1808. Immediately, there was a split between criollos and peninsulares on how to react to the situation. the Peninsulares, and the Royal High Court of Mexico, which had assumed power amidst the political confusion, wanted to recognize one of the provisional governments in Spain. But the city council in Mexico City, which was run by criollos, wanted New Spain to declare itself to be autonomous from the politics in Spain while also remaining loyal to Fernando VII and to rule on his behalf until he returned to power. The Viceroy, which was the highest ranking position in New Spain, was born in the Basque region of the Iberian Peninsula, and even though he was from Spain, he actually supported the criollos and their idea to declare New Spain to be autonomous from all provisional governments in the Iberian Peninsula. So now, we had a dispute between these two groups. On the one side was the Viceroy, as well as the criollos of the city council in Mexico City, who wanted colonial Mexico to become autonomous from Spain. And you had the Peninsulares, who were backed by the Royal High Court of Mexico, and they wanted to be under the control of the provisional government in Sevilla. As this dispute was unfolding, the criollos and the Viceroy were convinced that the Royal High Court of Mexico and the Peninsulares would eventually give up an ally with Joseph Bonaparte. So the pro-criollo Viceroy began appointing criollos to high-ranking positions in the colonial government, and he even mobilized some of his loyalists in the colonial military to prepare for a possible showdown with the Peninsulares. Then, on September 15, 1808, about 300 Spanish colonial soldiers who were supporters of the Peninsulares stormed the National Palace in Mexico City and arrested the Viceroy and deported him back to Spain as a prisoner on conspiracy charges. Then, they replaced him with a high-ranking pro-Peninsular military officer to serve as Viceroy. They also arrested the criollos who were on Mexico City's city council. For the next 2 years, various criollos planned a conspiracy to overthrow the pro-Peninsular government in Mexico City. In the early months of 1810, in the city of Santiago de Querétaro, criollos began planning to launch an armed rebellion against Mexico City, after which, if successful, they had hoped to expel the Peninsulares from power and install their own provisional government in the name of King Fernando VII. Miguel Hidalgo, a priest who is regarded in Mexico as the founding father of the nation, was a key member of this group of conspirators. There were also criollos who were trained members of the colonial military who were on board with overthrowing the Peninsulares in the capital. The plan was to begin their armed rebellion on October 1st of that same year. However, in September, the Peninsulares got news of the conspiracy. And on the evening of September 15, 1810, Miguel Hidalgo, while he was in the town of Dolores, which is in the state of Guanajuato, was given word that their plot was discovered. So, it was now or never. And on the following day, in a somewhat hasty decision, Hidalgo rallied the local townspeople, who themselves were also fed up with the Peninsulares, and called on them to pick up their weapons and to begin their fight to overthrow the government in Mexico City. This day, September 16, 1810, is today regarded in Mexico as the first day of the armed struggle for independence that lasted until September 27, 1821. One important thing to note, the vast majority of the pro-Peninsular forces were actually born in Mexico as well. The leadership of Spain's colonial military was mostly made up of Peninsulares, but the soldiers were mostly criollos and mixed-race people. For example, Vicente Guerrero, who is one of Mexico's founding fathers, was the son of a high-ranking member of the Spanish colonial military. So, you could describe the Mexican War of Independence as a civil war between two sides fighting for power in Mexico, while trying to figure out what to do in the midst of a chaotic situation in Spain under Joseph Bonaparte. Remember, both Miguel Hidalgo and the Peninsulares claimed to be fighting in the name of the Spanish king, Fernando VII. Mexico's independence forces, which were mostly a mix of mestizos, indigenous people, and Mexican-born Spaniards, swelled to more than 50,000 people under Hidalgo's leadership. But his army, except for a few people in its leadership, was not really an army at all, nor was Hidalgo a trained military leader. When Hidalgo's group of fighters reached its first major confrontation with colonial military forces in Guanajuato, the situation quickly descended into chaos. When the residents of the city of Guanajuato learned of the approaching mob and their cause against the colonial government, some joined them, but others, including civilians, colonial soldiers, the city mayor, and others who were loyal to the colonial side, gathered inside a fortified storage building in hopes of avoiding the violence. When the mob reached the building, where the people were barricaded, a Peninsular soldier emerged from the building to negotiate a surrender, but he was killed by Hidalgo's men. When the fighting escalated, Hidalgo's forces lit the building's doors on fire, entered inside, and proceeded to mercilessly vanquish the people inside. And this battle marked the start of an 11-year war that had atrocities committed by both sides. One key takeaway for anyone who wants to study this war objectively is that there were people of all racial backgrounds on each side. This isn't the story of a local militia fighting against an army of foreigners. This conflict was closer to something that could best be described as a civil war.